This video interview was made possible by a grant from Skip Paul, administered by the May Temkin Fund at the University of Wisconsin Law School. Good morning. I'm Frank Turkheimer from the University of Wisconsin Law School. We are in the beautiful home of Justice and Mrs. Bach. Justice Bach has graciously agreed to an interview in connection with his own background and with his involvement in the trial of Adolf Eichmann here in Israel 45 years ago. I'd like to thank Justice and Mrs. Bach for making their home available, and Justice Bach for agreeing to go over some of these things that now took place almost half a century ago.
Mm-hmm. Very pleased to see you here.
Thank you. I think I'd just like to start with a little bit of personal background. You were born, I believe, in 1927 in Germany.
That's right.
And how long did your family stay in Germany?
Well, I stayed until the age of 11. We were very, very lucky. We left Germany in 1938, 2 weeks before the notorious Kristallnacht, you know, when all Jews were arrested. And we went to Holland. And we left Holland in 1940, 1 month before the German invasion of Holland. And we came here then on the ship, the Patria, which was sunk on the next journey after that, with 250 people killed. So we were always sort of one step ahead.
As I recall, your departure from Germany was not altogether smooth. Maybe you want to tell us about how that happened.
Yes. Well, my father, Victor Bach, he worked in heavy industry. He was a general manager of a big firm. And actually, we wanted to leave before, but in 1938, the beginning of 38, when there was the Czechoslovak crisis, the Gestapo took our passports away, because maybe they thought that my father knew a lot about the potential industry, military industry in Germany. And when then Chamberlain came to Munich, there was this temporary lull, we got our passports back. So nowadays, when Chamberlain is criticized, I agree with that rationally, but I keep quiet because it most probably saved our lives. When we came to the Dutch border, some SS people came in and asked us, family Bach, said yes, raus, out. So we had to leave. We went into a shed with about 10 SS men with pistols all around us. They forced us to open the bags and they threw out everything, all corners. We didn't know what was happening, there were telephone calls going on, and the train wanted to leave. My father asked to wait for a few minutes until this is cleared up. And then the officer came back and said, all right, get out. So we quickly tried to pick our things together, and we ran towards the train, which had started to move. And then an SS man came, and I was very little, and then an SS man came behind me and kicked me in my behind, permit me. And in a way that helped me a little bit, because I flew up the stairs into the train. And for a few minutes we sat there on our luggage, stunned, and didn't have enough courage or enough strength to go back to the compartment. And then I remember a Dutch customs official came. He was not even particularly friendly, but he spoke to us like an ordinary human being. That triggered off a reaction with me. I then started to cry. The fact that someone in uniform spoke to us like human beings, that trigger. And then somehow the atmosphere was all right. We had a drink, and that was a way which. But the fact that I was literally kicked out of Germany, that only later became something which sort of stuck in my memory.
How many of you were there? Was it your parents?
It was my parents and my sister and myself.
Now, this incident with being kicked out of Germany was something that came back about 60 years later on, isn't that right, isn't it?
Yes, that's right. It was now a few years ago. I got a telephone call from the German ambassador to Israel, And he told me that the president of Germany and the German government had decided to award me these sort of called Verdienstkreuz. That's the highest distinction that they can award to someone. And he asked me whether I would be prepared to accept that. So I asked him, first of all, tell me why the German authorities think that I deserve it, why the president thinks so. And then he said that what you did in the Eichmann trial and your cooperation with German prosecutors in connection with other trials against Nazi prisoners and accused people under the Nazi regime, together with a certain openness as far as the new generation of jurists is concerned and the judges and the prosecutors, all that together to their mind justified that. So I agreed, and then there was a ceremony at the place of the German ambassador, and lots of people invited. And then when I had to make a speech, I couldn't refrain but to tell that story of how I was kicked out of Germany. And I said, as I think I didn't deserve that then, I have certain doubts whether I deserve that distinction now. But anyway, I was grateful for the gesture that was done.
How long did your family stay in Holland?
In Holland, we just stayed for 1 year and three quarters.
And was the plan always to leave as quickly as possible to come to Palestine?
Well, no, I don't know whether quickly as possible, because my father had also some work together with a factory that he worked in Germany. There was some cooperation in Holland. But we knew, my father was one of the leading Zionists of Germany, so I knew that he would come to Palestine. But my father did not want to leave Europe before he had saved the whole of his family. I mean, as I said, the rest of my family were not Zionists. My uncles were all arrested in the Kristallnacht this night, and they were sent to concentration camps, Dachau, Buchenwald, etc. But my father managed to get them entry certificates to Palestine. And he managed to get them out of the concentration camps then in 1938. And therefore, strangely enough, the rest of our family came to Palestine before we did. And we were almost stuck. And I forget one of the, as I say, in Germany, I went to also ironically, to the Theodor Herzl School of Adolf Hitler Square. You know, Theodor Herzl, the leader of the Zionist movement, and here next to Adolf Hitler Square. But in Holland, I went to a mixed school, but there were hundreds of Jewish pupils in this school. And my best friend, who was not Jewish, he, some time ago, he called me and he said that after the war, he made some research and he found out that of all the Jewish pupils in our school, that I'm the only one who remained alive. And that all those who were there when the Germans entered, not one managed to remain alive. And what really gave me the shivers, I later read in history books that between the outbreak of war in September 39 and March 40, when we left Holland, Hitler had fixed seven times a date for the invasion of Holland. And he each time postponed it at the last minute. Once the astrologers had told him that the star situation wasn't so favorable. Once they heard something on the BBC and they thought the British were suspecting something. A number of times weather conditions were not so good. And that's why he postponed it. But when I then heard that that none of those who were there when the Germans entered had remained alive, and only we, because we left a month before, then the idea of what life depends on gives you food for thought.
And that, of course, coupled with the Patria incident.
Yes. Yes. So everyone thought at the time that my father had a sort of sixth sense as to when to detach himself. So when the German army during the war approached through Libya and Egypt, approached Palestine, everyone looked at my father and said, where are you going? Where are we going now? So he said, no, here is the last stop. Here we won't budge. So then people said, oh, because of that, Rommel had to go back, you know, the German army had to retreat. And they thought that really explains history in a real sense.
When you you received, of course, your initial education then in Palestine, which became Israel. I gather you went back to England. Then you went to England for legal education.
That's right. At that time, there was no law faculty yet at the Hebrew University. That was before the state was created. And I received a sort of honorary scholarship for studies in England, and that's why I went to London and studied at London University College. And I also am an English barrister.
And on returning to Israel, what was your first law job?
What was my first?
Your first job, your legal job.
Ah, when I joined the army, I was already a lawyer in England, and then I came to Israel. I was in the legal department of the army. I was the army defense counsel at first. That's where I also met my wife, who was serving in the army at the time. Then I was a prosecutor, and then finally a judge. Actually, I'm still on the reserve duty. I could have been released, but when I got to that age, I asked the commander-in-chief to postpone my release, and he did this. And so I'm still a member of the. I'm now a colonel, and I'm a judge of the Army Supreme Court, Court of Appeal, and only when there are special cases, I'm called there. And that was my first. And then, when I left the Army, I joined the State Attorney's Office, and there I first as an assistant, and then as a deputy, and then I became the Chief State Attorney of Israel.
Let me interrupt for just a second. For the American viewers of this video, State attorney means different things. So could you describe what the responsibilities are of the state attorney?
The state attorney is a completely non-political person. He's in charge of all the litigation to which the state is a party. It's not only a director of prosecutions, and it is not only criminal cases, but criminal cases, civil cases, administrative cases, everything in which the state is involved is handled by state attorneys in Israel. And as the chief state attorney, I was responsible administratively and also legally for all the activities of all the state district attorneys and all the state attorneys all over the country.
To put it into a chronological perspective, in what year did you become a member of the State Attorney's Office?
That was in 1953, and I was that until 1982. I was in the State Attorney's Office. In 1961, I became the Chief State Attorney until 1982, and then I was appointed Justice of the Supreme Court of Israel.
In that period between 1953 and 1961, were your responsibilities in all of the areas? What kind of work did you do in those 7 years?
Well, I was mostly criminal cases. Some very special cases, some big espionage cases, some big murder cases, some cases of the military background. I mean, I handled some of the major criminal cases in Israel. Usually, as I worked in the state attorney's office, that was mostly, I usually appeared on appeal before the Supreme Court as an attorney. But in a number of special cases, I also handled them as first instance.